citizens that are just getting into the least amount of GDP, or is that because we're going for DNS because we don't even catch up with data? So also DNS over HTTP, as I mentioned before, we have a DNS stack, just for things and stuff, or we can trigger the lower trusted network. So back to the DNS resolution, like it belongs, because the IP belongs to a particular country's IP space. So that effectively reduces the total number of data we can transfer to just improve the reliability of it. And the last thing I want to make before we move into other good stuff is ICMP. This is actually the wrong record than like DNS. I think that's the complexities of implementing it. Maybe people shy away, but there are, you know, samples in the wild that use this. One nice thing about like a hacker request is you can arbitrary payload size. Again, as a developer, it's an important thing for me. We can effectively extract data and tap arbitrary data on the packet without worrying about, you know, protocol syntax limitations, stuff like that. In terms of improvements, we can use alternate codes. So a lot of people use a hacker request and reply, but that's not the code that ICMP supports. The time exceeded messages are almost as popular and not as well modeled, although they can't transfer as much data. But like a time exceeded packet, you can easily get, you know, 2 bit blocks, which is pretty decent. Smaller payloads with more volume is another strategy we employ both with DNS and ICMP. So you have to make trade-offs there, and usually you're aiming for, you know, the metric higher packet volume for just smaller packets in general. Also, the fact that ICMP is connectionless means that you start pushing really large packets and you're running into deliverability issues. And then last, I want to do a shout out to Sammy Capcar's project on that, where he demonstrates a great way to discover IP addresses for a UDP NAT bypass. Effectively, you have an agent behind a NAT firewall making a type 8 echo request out to an IP address, and at some point, the server requests in and responds to that echo request saying, hey, whatever that packet was, it never reached the server, the TTL was exceeded. But I suppose these are connectionless packets, but the NAT on the perimeter will let that packet in and back to the agent because it just assumes that it was a reply from a server trying to help out. And we're going to go with these tools, the UDP NAT punch thing is an entirely different beast and really neat. Alright, so with that, we transition to trust conflicts. So a couple of, you know, basic protocols, I think HTTP, most people are familiar with that. DNS, maybe if you've used an advanced tool or more advanced tool. But also, you're going to look at the HTTP layered on top of trusted assets. So there are a lot of different assets we might look at for this, and I kind of loosely group them into categories, although I'm sure these aren't entirely accurate. When I look at email assets or chat assets, these systems are generally dead drops. If you're talking about that, if we are going to use a trusted asset, we're third party, we're usually having some system where we drop data and pull that data back out on the other side.
Is parsed the metadata with the extracted and available that responds to the page, assuming the hash. So we can have example uploads using comments, and
interactive show and TW. Sometimes I make a bit more, you know, funny games. If you want to take it, that helps welcome. And it's with that that we come into our cloud abuse and take them along. So this is kind of a leg of our entire C2. And first, I'll establish in my mind what I mean when I say cloud. So cloud, there's a few lots of public providers, but there's really 9 to 4 primary ones that represent the largest market share. Specifically, I'm going to leave my items primarily focused on AWS and a little bit of GCP. Together, they represent about 84% of all the cloud provider markets. So I think it's probably what attackers are going to aim for anyways. There's a ton of functionality in the cloud, but I'm going to keep this talk focused on C2 primitives. We're not going to talk a lot about, you know, abusing AWS CDKs or anything like that. That's, you know, obviously related. So I broke down the cloud problem into two primary issues. One is we have trust boundary problems. That represents sort of breaking our classic ideas of trust boundaries. And two, the assets that the cloud have are very dynamic, and the traditional protocols, which call it the systems that we have in place now, aren't set up to handle them effectively. So in terms of trust boundaries, once again, we have a client connecting to a server, and so remember, the primary can use some reference for trust repositories, as well as traffic is, or this particular endpoint is benign, or it's malicious. But it's all cloud in there, and it gets kind of complicated right now. We have traffic moving up render towards some generalized cloud domain, and we might be able to make some to the traffic based on qualities of the domain or the URL, but at the end of the day, it's a really high complexity sitting on top of HTTP that we're not really ready to do. So examples of these domains are familiar, like Azure websites, Amazon.com, one of the popular ones, Akamai.net, or the popular cloud.net that was used for Fortune. And second half of the issue is, once again, dynamic assets. So we have trust problems, but also we have this problem, you know, how will TLS scale with the cloud, and how much I ran to this before, this is why SNI exists. So before, we just had a server, and IP, and everything together, like a domain, and everything's fine. Now we have migrants all over the world, and we're, like, abusing DNS in a way to reduce trip time to any particular server. What that meant is, the servers need to break TLS, or have some ability with TLS, which we'll talk about in just a second. So TLS is kind of protocol that hasn't taken a hit, how does it deal with you know, the reallocation of assets, the redistribution of assets to a particular person? How can we represent ownership, and how can we prevent misconfiguration, especially when misconfiguration is so isolated? When it's so easy to misconfigure cloud assets, and then on top of that, it's so easy to recruit because they're in just one spot on the internet, when there's a problem with making people responsible for the assets they have control over. So this all came about in sort of the first round of cloud getting its punch in 2015. I think we've heard that. In a classic sense, we make some HTTP-kins.com, which resolves to a quick IP effectively the closest server to us. We'll call 1234. As SNI happens, we'll effectively tell the server, hey, we're looking for kins.com, by the way. We can request this made against that server with the host header sent to Azure. Then we go to puppies.com, and the same process happens again when the request is effectively the same. We're making the same request to the same server, and the only thing that changes is the host header. So attackers obviously figured out how to use this by making a web request to onhost.com. When that packet or when that request leaves the network, it gets on the web logs as kins.com, but we forge the host header through the Azure net. And the Azure solution happens the same way. Ultimately, we'll be able to connect to a website that the provider never thought we were connecting to. And once again, it's really the intricacies I'm talking about. We never assume that a host header can make that much difference in terms of the website content that you wrote, but it does now. An IP means nothing. It's just an IP on a cloud plane somewhere. So in terms of abuse, one domain fronting is what's max tile hosting. We can host static payloads and get stuff that was ready for, as well as shoveling dynamic data in the same container. So AWS, these look like S3 buckets, GCP has a cloud storage, those are the same thing, and Azure has blob storage. It's kind of like a bunch of nuances to it, but generally the links look like SAS links and they're with the ledger. But I would note that the bucket ID can actually go to different places depending on how you limit. So you can have a bucket ID that is specific to you, you can put in the DNS name, or bucket ID can put in the URL. And a lot of people maybe assume that, well, we can detect you using S3 bucket because it identifies you and says my bucket, Mr. Evil bucket, Amazon AWS. But if you want to use bucket to extract a bucket name from the URL, then how would you know the difference between any S3 and Amazon AWS link? We also have serverless code, so the passive traffic redirection is part of domain fronting for Google Cloud Platform specifically. There's some code that gets loaded into an engine, and then we receive a web request, which is forward that request on. App engines like apps like and Lambda obviously has a unique IDs to execute APIs. I think more just once again, the point they can extract is how many people are looking at these. How many people are familiar with what these URLs look like? You know, if an innocent analyst saw these URLs in a log, would they know the difference between what your Azure website's URL, or an app's URL, or even an Amazon or an AWS Lambda endpoint? And so with that, I want to get into the table of primitives. So this is really my attack on DNS. Once again, TLS has had its meaning in terms of you know, SNI and how to deal with dynamic cloud infrastructure, and now we're looking at the way DNS has to obtain records. We get left out, the record scene is becoming pretty intense. At any given time, an organization has to maybe manage 100 domain names or 100 domain names or even thousands in a records file, and those records are static. They just get implemented when they point to a cloud asset. The asset's not very dynamic. There's been a top research in this area, Patrick Cook, or Alan Kent, I'm sorry, I'm wrong name. He actually did an entire thesis paper on the analysis of DNS and cybersecurity. He had a link down to the address route 311 to do names over takeovers. If you guys haven't read this stuff, you definitely should. These people have been screaming this rage. These cloud providers are vulnerable to like thousands of domains being taken over, and really the truth is these DNS records are not correct to handle this sort of stuff. So looking at the DNS takeover, this is organizing into two primary schools of thought. So one is you would go after a CNAME record. CNAME records be used in bug bounty programs where you're trying to identify a URL that a domain that points to say GitHub, where they sensor moves their GitHub account. They're frequently called subdomain takeovers, although I think what I'll show actually kind of opens up the idea that subdomain takeover could mean something different. The alternative is going after names over you know, if you're interested in taking over an entire domain, that's where we'll have 33% comes in. But one of the others, I sort of ask myself, it's like we must target IP based records instead of domain name records and other domain names. So I came up with two problems that we tried to solve before we do this. One is how quickly can we actually collect your address? It's kind of a big problem, right? It's like beforehand, we have to go to a UPS provider and buy a server, and people give you an address, and you have to like claw at them to give you a address, and we pay more money. And our cloud provider is like, average API, my friend, you send about being multi-threaded 10 threads a minute. And it's like, well, we accurately check for anyone on record. This is actually the larger problem in screening things. DNS doesn't really work the same way backwards. So we're trying to find any open record IP address, and there's not a lot of great repositories for us. But here's the concept. So the concept is we would communicate with someone and collect a random IP. That IP is now ours. The cloud providers gave it to us. We own it, it belongs to us, and all we have to find out is that record interesting? If we go to a particular repository or go to a DNS record repository and say, you know, is the DNS name associated with this IP? And I say yes. What record do we can now sort of keep the IP and that DNS name? The DNS will resolve, look at your own file with your own, and we just hope that record stays alive for as long as possible. Process with any records we wanted or to handle failure conditions. So without this record repository, trying to use major records, that's kind of the idea of reversing it. But there's a problem with that in that they're not necessarily accurate, but rather we point to a domain record that belongs to like the provider that hosts the infrastructure that we're going to the truth I'm interested in. Records have a big project called OpenDNS, that's a bunch of repositories for MX records. You can definitely use that. These files are massive, so you can't really parse them. They're all moved out, the ones that go was used at the top of the file. There is a couple of ways that you can find out what the public private is paid, and you can find out on the website this one that I require approval or they're charged to get access to that data API. But although the folks at security sort of have this outcome, this is a website that is just what we need. It's a repository of DNS information, and they provide APIs and we can query stuff on it. So with that, we have the final piece of puzzle on what we see today, the Amazon cloud record, because it's doing through trash on the internet. But it has to be linked to one of the best records, and it uses cloud IDs for fast cycling it. Now this varies depending on the provider. I thought AWS would be cool with the best. It's a big speed that you can request IDs, but also the fact that the Azure, or the AWS, which called Network, is not available, so there's just more DNS records waiting in that space. Azure's pretty good, it's slow, I think you might be turned out, I'm not sure if I tried that. And GCP is just a pool, it's a weird, it's like, they carry forward, so if you can only request IDs, it's supposed to serve the same IDs back. So it's really cool to do it, like, it tracks that, it'll target a particular percentage of IPs, which it feels like it's soon enough of them before it gives up, and then you just wait a day and try again. Excellent. Cool. So I'm sorry to record this. Actually, I recorded this in the thread over here. But this is the hunting period of AWS. It's really good. First, actually, saw was not good enough for seeing something like this and all that. So I think that saw it and gave it up. And it's because eventually here it should hit another record for some top-level server. It's kind of soothing. Nice. I can hear this excitement to the one that happens so bad. But yeah, now we effectively have an IP with the domain record that is above server and someone has more instance. This is a proof of concept, but this is actually a bit unique in comparison to the projects in that operation. We've been using this for about 6 to 8 months. All of our production infrastructure uses this strategy. And we just cycle IPs. We have 20 of them at this point, and we use them for global operations. So I would be surprised if this isn't being performed by global actors at this point. We can talk about the names for some crazy things. We found antivirus vendors, we found research institutes, government agencies. Obviously, we won't hear the same thing after the blogs I posted about when we take over crews. But this is extremely accessible, except that this is not contrived at all. This is literally the first run in the loop right over here. If we sat here and ran them, I bet you we have 10 or 15 in a 5 minute period. So some final thoughts. I think the key points to pick because talk is C2 is a very complex discipline. The implementations vary greatly, and not always for great reasons, but usually the particular design decisions are random. These people are choosing HTTP for reasons, they're choosing ICMP for reasons. I think the more we can understand that C2 is a discipline that has been crafted over a long time and people are sort of in these modes now, the better we're going to be able to handle the changes coming soon. There's a ton of other research already available. That's really one thing I want to point out this talk is, you come here to show a proof of concepts and say, oh, there's a lot of some of you guys who don't use this. But the reality is, people have been releasing this for years, and they're getting the credit they deserve. I think because people think it's still theoretical, or it's not really easy to operationalize, but I think they just solving using problems. I think domain fronting is just the first crack in a long series of cracks, and this DNS takeover thing is going to be the next. Their money was growing, and cloud is representing some very unique challenges for us. So next, I just want to cover what was it. I'm a guy who likes to give information. I did touch on the offensive approach, which is a self-discipline, but related discipline. This would include, like, asset collection, traffic redirection, stage segmentation. There are a bunch of great people who help us to take care of some stuff, help for free, and give all the resources you need for it. But really, all these individual primitives can't work without that knowledge either. So, that's really where I think people lose the connection, as they can see, okay, yeah, I use Firestore for C2, but how it actually build it. The second is the specific architecture details, so like language choice, the details surrounding encoding or RPLs or the deep complexities. Obviously, the source code will be in your hands if you want to take a look at it, but then also the implementation costs as well. All of this stuff is free. I'll post some additional resources, so Razor Labs has a good blog with detailing a bunch of basic C2. My detector hook, they have a documented wiki of a bunch of, different samples and all the C2 styles that they use. I use that a lot for referencing material in this presentation. This one, Jeff, has an amazing LinkedIn infrastructure wiki that actually has many of the links I put in the slideshow on there as well. So if you want to visit one link after this presentation, it should be that link. There's domain fronting tools and also a bunch of tools for subdomain takeover, in a classic sense where you're looking for CA records that are usable. And with that, I want to thank everyone for coming. I actually finished all of it, which is pretty good. I have a couple of handles up there, and honestly, you couldn't tell many recording demos in the car ride on the way over here. I will upload code soon, probably tonight, but I couldn't. If you want to just monitor my GitHub, they'll probably be under there. It's gap.com/append or something like that. And I guess I'm open for any questions people have. I'm told to tell you where microphones, if you guys want to line up on the microphones or. You were saying that you're doing GCP address spaces, it causes too much heat in the pool, and you can use that as a private service and basically force it to go into the pools. So that's interesting. I'm not really sure what the backend looks like. That might be a possibility. My assumption is that they're effectively designing a floating pool for almost a casual reason, but if you didn't hear this question effectively, in GCP, what is the pullback we need and could be used for a denial of service? I'm assuming they would just expand the pool as necessary. There's also account limitations, so if you have Google Cloud Platform only lets you have a certain number of IPs at a time, the same thing goes for AWS and Azure. You can use those quotas, but I'd be surprised if the quotas ever exceed the pool.
Do you see any advantage to adopting HTTP3, which is based on UDP, or so TCP?
Honestly, I'm not that familiar with it. I can't think of any, but I also don't want to say the opposite either. Okay, thank you so much.
Jeremiah Wilson, who is taking us to the summit.
Hi, welcome back.
even bigger than us. It's doing a lot of things we should have done ourselves. Okay? That's not what's happening. I think it's important as I go through. Cyber insurance has been around since 1999. We haven't had a significant presence in things like Black Hat. We should have over the years. So the incentives and what I talk about, we need to use the history of insurance just overall. Which were good, which were safe, and also when faced with historic situations, why protection pattern, so we can see the tax line.